afternoon. Welcome to the 1 p.m. lecture, or 1:15 p.m. lecture. Depends on how long it takes us to get set up. In the old days, we could just sit down and start talking. Now we have to get the cameras ready and rolling and the microphones and everything positioned. Modern day world. I have a handout that that's in the back. Okay, everybody has it. That includes some notes from the last time we talked. I know there was a couple of people that came up afterwards and asked me some questions about some terms that I had used during the lecture. And so I wrote some notes from the previous lecture talking about that gives you an idea or definition of some of the terms and some of the ideas and concepts that we talked about. And I also included some of the things that I'll be talking about today. So I'm not going to really follow the outline. It's just kind of an all-encompassing outline for the what I call a little mini-series where I talked about a month ago, and then this month I'm going to continue with the concept of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 2, 3, 4. And then next month I'm going to conclude and talk about the idea of 4. Last time I talked about 2. Today I'm going to talk about 3. And then next time I'll talk about 4. And then we'll have maybe in the future some exciting lecture about 5. What kind of inspired me to deal with this? A number of things. One, it was just something that came in my meditation, and I thought it was important, and so I wanted to pass along any information that I ideas, thoughts that came to me. And then I also came across a passage in the Tao Te Ching, which I've heard a number of times throughout the years here that I've been at the temple. Chapter 42, Lao Tzu says, "The Tao begot one, one begot two, two begot three, and three begot 10,000 things." To me, that had some meaning to it. There was something important in that concept, and so I've taken it, and now I'm elaborating on it a little bit. And I'm talking about the two, the three, and the four being everything else. Or the 10,000 things, as Lao Tzu had pointed out. When I was talking about the concept of two, or this idea of two, last time, I had mentioned that in life, everything is paired off. Everything is a duality. We have a right hand and a left hand, and a right leg and a left leg. And you can say, well, that's four. and I said, you know, that's true, but it's two pairs of two, which gets you to four. And that's next month. We have two eyes, two ears. We get married and we have a couple. You have a boss and you have the employee. You have white and black. And I suggested or strongly said, it's a very powerful idea, this duality, this idea of duality. It's powerful and it's important. And it starts at the top. And one of the things that I was suggesting that we have a reflection of two realities that comes down into this world, into this universe, and that's what we're seeing when we have this duality. It's just a reflection of the ultimate cosmic principles. And I had mentioned that those principles are called primordial spirit and primordial matter. And I added this adjective primordial because what that means is it exists before time existed. So it exists out, what we say is outside of time. And I also mentioned that that's a really difficult concept or idea or thought to try and communicate to somebody. And it's difficult because in the world that we live in, it is a time universe. And so our head is wired to the concept of time. It's there. This concept of time is inherent to our being in this world. The concept of no time, timelessness, is inherent to these two ultimate realities. Spirit does not exist in time. It's not subject to the laws of time. And saying that, what I'm saying or suggesting is that therefore, when we talk about something being eternal, our head can't comprehend, well, what does that mean? We always have to think, okay, I exist, and the reason I exist is because my father and my mother came together, and they had a child. They had me. I popped out. Well, my mother had a mother and a father, and my father had a mother and a father. And, of course, my grandparents had a mother and a father. And you keep going back, and very, very quickly you realize, well, wait a minute, where was the first one at? Where was the first mother and the first father? And philosophers and scientists have been, in a frustrating way, trying to deal with that idea, that concept, for all time, since time began. If I could inject a little bit of humor. And so when we start talking about this concept of God, and then people say, okay, fine, God created the universe, but what created God or who created God? And the answer is, when you talk about God, that's probably not a really good word, but it communicates an idea, divine reality, life, reality, whatever word you want to use, it moves out of the realm of time into the realm of timelessness, and so this concept of beginning has no meaning to it. And so we say God always existed. Our head can't comprehend that, but it can't comprehend it because it's wired into, there has to be a beginning and an end. And the answer is no. There was no beginning. There was no end to reality. It always existed. And of course, then you struggle with it. You struggle with it. And finally, a mystic comes along. And you ask the mystic about this concept of God, about the concept of some divine being, Nirguna Brahman, Saguna Brahman, and all of that. Spirit and matter, and we talked about it, Prakriti and Purushra are the Sanskrit terms that we use to describe those. Those terms, Prakriti and Purushra, mean it doesn't exist in this time realm. Whenever you talk about those two terms, you've automatically moved from this realm to that realm. And you say, well, to the mystic, you say, well, okay, tell me where the beginning was. Tell me who was the mother of God and father of God. Where was their beginning and all of that? And what the mystic says is, it's very simple. You sit down, you come into a meditative posture, you close your eyes, you bring your head between the eyes at the root of the nose, and you sit there, you do a double exhale to the left, bring your head forward, and you merge with the reality. And when you merge with the reality, you will understand. Because at that point, you've now moved yourself from this universe into that real universe, and now it can be comprehended. And then you come back into this world, and someone comes up to you and pokes you and says, okay, tell me about it. And I say, well, what you do is you sit down and your spine is erect, bring your attention between the eyes or the root of the nose, and you experience it. Because the only way that you can understand it and comprehend it is by experiencing it yourself. And that's what all mysticism is about. Religion, again, we have a duality. We have religion and we have mysticism. That's duality. We always seem to always come back to that. And religion says, well, okay, the priest is going to go and merge with God, and the priest is going to then come down and spread the word and give the blessings and, so to speak, do all the work, the spiritual work that needs to be done in the world. And everybody else can go around and do their own thing, do their own job and all of that. And that's religion. Type of evolution, that's fine. But all it is a starting point. All it is a point where you can start at. And it always, always, always comes back to a point where if you really do, and at some point in your evolution, I promise you, you will reach a point where you'll say, I want to know more than what I can, than what some goofy priest tells me. I want to know more than that. And that's where you get into mysticism. And mysticism says, here's techniques. Here's 1,000 techniques. And you can use any of them. And if you use these techniques, you will start to comprehend what this realm is that God lives in. And you'll start to comprehend it. And you do it by experiencing it yourself. And each technique gives you the experience, and what they do is they give you a different viewpoint. You know, like a camera has a different viewpoint for everybody. So you have three cameras on a scene, and they switch from one to another, and they try and give you, in a movie, a feeling of what's happening. And the way they do that, whether you know it or see it or not, is they're switching the camera. They're going from a distance scene, they'll do a close-up scene to the right, to the left, with one person in it, with more than one person, and they're constantly changing the scene. The function of that is so that you at the other end can get some realistic perception of what's going on. And it's the same way with different techniques that you do in mysticism. We'll see, you know, 'cause you say, well, how come there's so many techniques? All the techniques just give you different camera angles to what this idea of God is all about. So the supreme being, Brahman, whatever word you want to use. Now, in their experience, they come into this world, and what happens is, you say, okay, tell me about God, to the mystic, and the mystic says, you sit down, you put your hands here, you do an om, you do this mudra, you close your eyes, and he gets about halfway through his spiel, and you say, stop, I know all of that, you told me that already, but I need something more. That's good, but I went home and I did all of that and nothing happened. And so the mystic says, well, okay, do it again. And you go back and forth, and pretty soon the mystic realizes, oh, here's a dum-dum. I'm going to have to give him words. I'm going to have to give her words. They need something else besides the technique. And so we get spiritual literature that comes down to us. And this literature, this spiritual literature that comes down to us, tells us in words what the experience is that we're trying to experience when we do our meditation. And then from that, we move over to this idea of in Hinduism, in Eastern philosophy, East Indian philosophy, where we have Vedas. And the Vedas are these ideas and concepts which were written down, and they were written down for forgive me if this is an unkind way of saying it, but for the ignorant masses, for the people that say, I know the techniques, I tried them, they don't work, I need words. And that's what the spiritual literature does. It gives us words. And so we can read the words, and we can start to study the words. And then we do two things. We read the words. We read the literature. And in the literature, it says, here's a technique. And then you start to remember, oh, yeah, that's what that mystic, that funny guy said to me, we need to do techniques. And it's two oars on a boat. One oar is study, and one oar says practice. So you have to study and you have to practice. And as long as you do both, you do the study and you do the practice, the boat goes where you want it to go, which is an evolution. And so we have Prakriti and Purushara. And what happened was Prakriti, as best I understand it, as best I understand the words and the studies, said, I want to experience something. And so Prakriti, Purushara, which is eternal, has no beginning, has no end. Purushara said it decided it wanted to experience something. It became aware of Prakriti, which is eternal, has no beginning, has no end. And the two came together, and in the coming together, creation occurred. Now what we say mystically is the world or the universe was projected out. Now the reason we say it was projected out is because there was something that was there before it existed, so it wasn't really created. What was created was time. And what was created was the universe in this time. Now, spirit, the one reality, is consciousness. And consciousness, when it manifests in the real world, winds up having the quality of time. So time is a quality of consciousness. Prakriti in its natural state, eternal state, has no qualities. Just like spirit in its natural state has no qualities. Because if you give it qualities, the only way you can do that is by putting it into a time realm. Prakriti has, when it drops into the universe and manifests itself, manifests in three qualities. The three qualities are called tamas, rajas, and sattva. Those are Sanskrit terms. And I have those on the paper, the handout that I have. Rajas, tamas, and sattva. And so here we get to this idea of the concept of three. And it is prakriti, which is a threefold nature to it. The threefold nature is called rajas, tamas, and sattva. And these three qualities of prakriti are called gunas. And the gunas are said to be the ultimate cause of all creations. I want to repeat that. Prakriti in its natural state really doesn't have any qualities. However, inherent in it, there are three qualities. Those three qualities are called the gunas. Now, gunas translates as ropes. And so when people start talking about it and trying to describe, well, what is it? They say, well, these three qualities are like strands in a rope. And if you imagine three strands are intertwined on a rope. And if you look at a rope, you'll actually see that. You get a lot of different kinds, but a lot of them are. You actually have three strands that are, and they form one. And so you say it's a single rope, which is true, but it has three qualities to it. Now, that leads us into where we get in, when I was younger, Christian background, they would talk about the Trinity. And that's what we're talking about here with the three gunas. The three gunas, on its ultimate level, is the Trinity. It's three things that exist. The three things exist together as one. They cannot be separated. They're like two sides of a coin. They cannot be separated. But when they manifest in this world, what happens is, before they manifest in this world, those three qualities, what they say, and what I'm dealing with is Sankhya Yoga philosophy now. Those three qualities are in perfect, absolute perfect equilibrium. When they come in perfect equilibrium, rajas, tamas, and sattva, they're prakriti. It becomes prakriti. Well, what is that? That's what exists out of time. It exists in a timeless realm. These three qualities, if I translated them into English, are light, darkness, and heat, or energy. And what they talk about in Sankhya philosophy, is that rajas is kind of the center intermediary state between darkness and light. And what has happened is the universe has manifested, and it's manifested because rajas has become activated. Rajas is energy. Rajas is activity. It's heat. It's passion. It's creation. And so it's through this particular guna that creation occurs. And as the creation occurs, what it does is it runs into a resistance. So it's rajas is expanding out. It's like the universe is expanding out. Life is being created. The universe is being created. Nothing's happening. This energy is just rushing out and nothing's happening. It meets up with this quality called tamas. Tamas is inactivity. It's lethargy. It's darkness. It runs into this, and when it runs into this, it creates friction, and that results in that process, that whole process results in the universe. Those two qualities interact and you get a universe. And the universe is created and it starts evolving. The evolving process is an activity that's occurring between this energy activity, trying to do something, trying to make something. Now I'm talking about on in terms of the universe, but when I say this, keep in mind that I'm also referring back to just our own particular life. We are created or projected out at some point, and within us as a creation are these three qualities, rajas, tamas, and sattva, just like in the universe. And as I said, this twofold nature is reflected on the highest level down to our level. So the same thing is with the three gunas. That threefold pattern is reflected from the highest level down to our level and to our life. And your life, whether you know it or not, can be defined by these three qualities. In your life, you have three things occurring. One is you have passion, you have activity, you have desires, you have things that you want to do in life, whether it's physically creating something or mentally creating something or even verbally creating something. So there's different levels of creation, but it's all following the same pattern of activity, rajas, and then at some point we get tired. And we say, I'm exhausted. I have to stop. And the stopping is the tamasic quality. They call it darkness. It really just means the opposite of light, which is the third one in there. So that third one is in there. What really is activating life and what really life is mostly about is the interaction of rajas and tamas. Now, if I take it a step further, in the Sankhya philosophy, Sankhya Yoga philosophy, we have rajas and tamas, those two interacting, but sitting there is this third quality, tamasic, which is a quality of light. They would say light without heat. They would relate it to something akin to consciousness as just kind of a hook to grab onto. Keeping in mind, Prakriti doesn't have any consciousness. It does not have. Spirit has the quality. Spirit is consciousness. And it is the driving force behind the manifestation of Prakriti, but Prakriti itself does not have consciousness. However, what's related to consciousness is the quality of sattva, this sattvic quality, this light quality. And so the universe evolves and it evolves out, and it evolves out because Purushra, spirit, had the desire to manifest itself. It had a creation, and it had great joy in this creation or this creative process. And it is trying to, as best I can say it or understand it, is have experiences. Its purpose of manifesting prakriti or interacting with prakriti is to have experiences. It has these experiences for a specific amount of time. Things happen. It is born. It goes through its life, whatever it is, on any level. Something happens. There's existence, a sustainment of a birth. There's a birth. If I go back to the original example, you are born, the universe is born, it exists for a period of time, and then it dies. The universe is born, it exists for a period of time, and then it dies. You are born, you exist for a period of time, and then you die. You have this threefold pattern that comes from this concept of threefold pattern of the gunas. And when the death occurs, nothing is lost. There isn't a loss of, how can I say, loss of energy, a loss of materiality or anything. There's just emerging back into this timeless realm. That's all there is. And at that point, these three qualities, three gunas, again become balanced. And they stay balanced for a period of time, and then the whole process occurs over again. So the universe is projected out. It exists for a period of time, and then it dies, what we would call dies. But the dying simply means it moves back into the timeless realm. And so this is this idea or the concept of the three gunas, Rajas, Tamas, and Sattva. And again, I mentioned that there's many, many different ways of expressing it, but whenever we come into a threefold pattern, the threefold pattern is the pattern of the gunas on the highest level coming down to our lowest level. As far as us as beings are concerned, the main pattern that manifests itself in this world of Rajas, Tamas, and Sattva would be what we call Ida, Pingali, and Susumna. And we have in our being three channels of energy. The three channels of energy are called, again, Ida, Pingali, and Susumna. Ida is the left path or the left channel. Pingali is the right channel. And Susumna is the center channel. These three channels are just channels of energy. It's what enlivens us. It is what gives life to you and gives life to me. It's the energy there. And as a human being or as a person, when we manifest based on one of those three channels. It could be Ida or the Idic channel, in which case we come down in a female form. It could be Pingala. There's more energy there, and so we manifest as a masculine form. And if I take and just stop for a moment and kind of put all of this together, what have I just said or what have I just talked about? What I'm talking about is Tao begot one, one begot two, two begot three, and three begot 10,000 things. The three is this three gunas projected out this universe, and everything in this universe is just a manifestation of those three gunas. No matter what you look at or what creation you look at, you could take a look at this podium. This podium is composed of three gunas. The three gunas, it's solid piece of furniture, and so it's a very tamasic. Tamasic has to do with darkness, but it also has to do with solidity, forms. Forms that take shape are tamasic forms. It has energy in it. There's energy there, but the primary form of the podium is tamasic. The primary form of your physical body is tamasic. It's a thing, as best I could say it. It's just a manifestation of a thing. And so it is a very tamasic projection or creation. In fact, if you could step out of the physical body and, so to speak, turn around and look at it. Imagine yourself stepping out of your physical body. You turn around and you look at it, or you become aware of it. You realize that it's a dark thing. And you realize it's a very heavy thing. And you realize it takes a lot of energy to get it up and moving around. Now, you may disagree with that. You may say, oh, no, energy is, you know, I get up in the morning and I just hop out of bed. Well, wait till you get a little bit older. You know, this morning, I remember when I was younger, I used to be able to pop out of bed. This morning I got up, I didn't pop out of bed like I used to. So the body is a tamasic thing. It has a lot of tamas in it. But mixed in with that is a lot of energy. There's something in this process of the manifestation of the physical body that does have energy in it, and the energy moves the physical body around. And those things are working with each other, the energy and the body. And at the end of the day, the body gets very tired and it has to become re-energized. It needs to be infused with more energy. I go to bed, I get up in the morning. Same thing. Get out of bed, I have all this activity. And so what I have is this interaction of rajas, the rajas quality and the tamasic quality, this energy and this lethargy, this energy, this machine, I guess is the best way, this machine I'm trying to move around. And as I walk through life, I realize that there's a third aspect that comes in there. The two things I've been talking about so far are pretty obvious. They're apparent. You see them, and it's just, I don't know how to say it, except they're very obvious. But then at some point you realize, well, wait a minute, there's this mechanism, there's something there that's working with that machine that's called the intellect. And this intellect is related to the sattvic quality, the quality of light. And there's a relationship between the light quality and the activity that's going on within the physical body, this energy and this lethargy. And in mystical terms, the universe has been projected out as, again, for a purpose. There's a specific reason that it was projected out. And it projected out because of the spirit, and the spirit interacting with primordial matter. And it projects out, and then it comes back in, and the spirit gets something from that whole process. And it's an intellectual thing. And the best way we can relate this whole pattern together is what I've been doing. It's hard not to do it. It's hard in talking about it. You can't stay away from it. But it's that the spirit is trying to know something. It's trying to understand that something in the whole process. That's why we're here. We're here living this life to evolve, what I would say, spiritually, so that the intellect gets something from it. The spirit gets something from it. So there's some value in this whole process for the spirit or our spiritual nature. And so that's this threefold pattern or this threefold nature, which threefold process which is occurring. And as best as I am able to kind of stumble through it a little bit in talking about it this afternoon, the threefold pattern and the threefold pattern of nature. So let me stop and then just review for a moment what I've said before I conclude. Prakriti, in its natural state, is unmanifest. It does not exist. It does not exist in time. Something happens, the spirit. The spirit moves me. The spirit moves the prakriti. And when that happens, an imbalance occurs between the three gunas, which are inherent in prakriti. That event is called creation in Western terms. It's called projection out in Eastern terms. And as the projection goes out, three things happen. There's activity, rajas. There's lethargy, solidity, a form, which is tamas. And there's some quality within the prakriti that is intellectual. It's there to have an evolutionary effect in this whole process. And that's the sattvic quality. And as best I can say it, it's intellect. Because the spirit isn't intellect, but the quality within the gunas is intellectual. And it's that process, through that whole process, that the spirit gains something and is the reason for the whole process. And with that, let me stop and just see if there's any questions, anything that you'd like to talk about. Yes.
I would just like to say, I love what you said all the way through, but especially at the end, you know, it's because it feels like reciprocity.
It's what?
Reciprocity?
Yes.
The spirit gets something and we get something.
Yes. Prakriti does not have consciousness. Spirit is consciousness. Without the spirit, prakriti would never manifest into form. So something's happening between the spirit and the prakriti, which causes the manifestation of forms. And there is something the spirit attains in that whole process, as best I understand it.
When you mentioned that, I think it's light, is that tamas?
The quality of light is
sattva.
Sattva. Okay.
And I notice in diagrams, not diagrams, but pictures showing a person thinking and having idea, they always use a light bulb. And that's what came to me.
Yes, because
that quality of light of this thinking process.
Yes, yes. Yes, it's the sattva is the light quality, and it's what we mean by the term enlightenment. It means the light bulb is going on. Mm-hmm. And that's really what enlightenment is saying. And it's the sattvic quality within the prakriti that is the light. But then the spirit is there watching. The spirit is the watcher on the hill. And that's something I like. It's a little poetic, but there it is, sitting and watching this whole process. The spirit does not have any quality of manifestation in and of itself.
So when you mention polarity, now prakriti and purusha, is this a polarity?
Yes. I'm saying prakriti and purusha are two different things. Mm-hmm. But they are both real, what we call real, which means eternal. Spirit is, what they say is, spirit is consciousness. And it has the quality of intellect if it manifests in the material world. Prakriti does not have consciousness. Prakriti is not consciousness. It has no capability of thinking for itself, so to speak. And it is also real, meaning eternal. Those two, mystically, the eternal question is, how did two things that are so different come together? Why did they come together? And that's what I've, again, as best I understand it and as best as I am able to communicate what I've been saying for the class this afternoon.
So, does this connect with reincarnation? We are projected out into this universe.
Yes.
Where it needs to experience
yes.
In this physical world, and maybe we get it, maybe we don't, and then we'll come back. And
yes, in fact, thank you. I meant to say that. What happens on the higher level always is reflected on the lower levels. And so what you have is the universe projected out, and then it's projected back in. There's a flow out and there's a flow in. It's called Nirguna Brahman and Saguna Brahman, the night of Brahman and the day of Brahman. There's a time when Brahman is active. Brahman, the creator God. And this process is actually, they'll talk about the night and day of Brahman, but they also talk about lifetimes of Brahman. And so they give it human characteristics, and that's because Brahman is reincarnated. And just as on the highest level, we have reincarnation of the universe. And they talk about other universes, an infinite number of universes that were projected out and projected back in, created and dissolved away. And it's just like us. We're in our reincarnational pattern are just following the same pattern as exists on the highest level, which is a reincarnational pattern. And our consciousness, the consciousness that you are, never dies. And that brings an interesting concept with it, which, unless there's any other questions, I'll close with this. Yes, it's related. Yes.
Are related but different.
It's a different way
to interpret it.
Yeah, where I started to get a little tongue-tied as I was going through this threefold pattern of the three gunas, again, is reflected in this universe in everything that we do. And I tried to say it's reflected in the Ida, Pingala, and Susumna. It's a threefold pattern. You talk about Ayurveda, there's a threefold pattern. They relate to that threefold pattern there intensely. And they just have a different way of looking at it. Again, it's that camera angle that I was talking about. They're taking the same concept and idea, they're just looking at it or working with it in a different angle, a different way. Yes.
Also the same patterns.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Yes. So, okay. Any other questions or comments? I appreciate that. It helps if with the questions, it helps me to know what you're thinking and then to kind of react to that. So I appreciate the questions.